I'd like today to greet our regional overseer, Pastor O. Williams, the ministers in this region, and all ministers and all the saints in Christ. Greetings in the wonderful name of Jesus.
Greetings.
It's good to be here with you today. I thank God for all that he's doing in my life. It's good to have Janet with me. Our boys are not here, but Janet is here. And, you know, we've been together now 34 years. And, you know, very much Janet shares in my ministry. I may not talk a lot about Janet like other people talk sometimes about their partners, but she knows that I love her. And, you know, I thank God for what he's doing and what he has done in our lives. It's awesome to be near today. It's just wonderful to just sense and feel the wonderful presence of God. If I was going to sing, I would just say, I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. Hallelujah. And I don't know about you. I feel quite like I'm going to be more instructional this afternoon. Maybe more with a pastor's heart. My mum says she thinks I'm an evangelist, but I think not. I don't know. I don't really know. But anyway, I feel more instructional today. And I could cry today, but I'm a crier, okay? So if I cry, don't worry about that. You know, I just love God. Amen. And I sense today that we all love him.
Amen.
We love him, don't we?
Yeah.
We do love him. And we're striving to please him.
Yeah.
And we know that there are tensions. I may talk a little bit about some of that today. We know that there are tensions in the life that we're trying to live and the life that the world tries to drag us into. I was thinking when I was sitting in my seat that, you know, there are some times when you're living and walking the Spirit that people don't understand you. There are things that you want to do, ways that you want to live your life, things that you want to do. And when you say it to people that don't understand what God is doing and how God is molding you in your life, they can't understand what it is that you want to do. But I want always to please God and not man. And when people don't understand what God is doing in my life, I know who I believe, and I'm persuaded that he's able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Do you believe that God is able to keep you? Do you believe it? I say to the brethren in Croydon, do you believe that your God is able? Oh, hallelujah. You need to believe it. You need to believe it. Because there's some times when it is just your belief and your faith in Jesus that sustains you in the challenges of life. Because nobody else understands what God is doing. Hallelujah. But you rest on him. You learn to lean on him. Oh, hallelujah. When the songwriter says, learning to lean on Jesus, finding more power than I ever dreamed. I'm learning to lean on Jesus. And it doesn't matter if you've been leaning 10 years, 20 years, that as long as you are in this world, you must learn how to lean on Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Glory to God. You know, sometimes it's like age. Sometimes when we get older, we think that we don't have to still do it. You still need to lean. You might not be as energetic as you was, but the sincerity and the understanding that only God can help you must never change. Oh, hallelujah. You must continue to believe in him. Let's praise the Lord today. Let's praise the Lord today. Oh, we're in, you know, one of the things that I want to encourage us today is don't let the devil hold you down. Don't let the devil make you feel that your life is not worth anything. Don't let the devil sit on you. Stand up in your faith and believe in your God. And know that if God loves you, You know, that's why some of the little songs that we used to sing, Jesus loves me. Them songs, they're ageless. Because you always need to know. When I hear the children sing that, it reminds me to sing that song again. Jesus loves me. This I know. For the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. He loves me. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, shekandarabo, sikyandaraba. Oh, hallelujah. Jesus loves us. And he's with us. You may not worship like somebody else, but he still loves you. You may not do it like somebody else, but he still loves you. You know, one of the things I'm learning, I can sit with those in silence, and I can sit with the noisy ones. And I can sit with those who just want to jump and shout. I don't really mind. I know where the Spirit of the Lord is. I know when God is working. I know how to set my antenna that I can that I can communicate with God. And so wherever we are, we communicate with him. Oh, hallelujah. And even if those around us are not, we still commune with him as friends with friends. Oh, hallelujah. More of late, I've just been like, Janet can tell you this, I've just been like sometimes reading old chapters and just trying to pick out some things from those chapters, because what I don't want to do today is to come with so much that you get nothing. Just want to focus upon one or two things. And when I'm not necessarily today going to speak about the anointing in terms of the power for going out and doing the miraculous things in terms of the gifts, but I'm going to speak about the power in terms of just daily living. Yes. Hallelujah. Yes. Just that step by step, that moment by moment experience with God. Hallelujah. And how we need to. And you know, when I was thinking about this, and I just kept hearing this thought in my mind, who are you? And it's like God was just telling me just to remind us who we are. And I think today, if I can just do that. And then I want to finish off just by telling us. You see, one of the things that we have to realize is that because we're living in this world and the spirit of this age and everything is against us. Yeah. And you can't go to just normal television. You can't even sometimes go to the God channels. But you, some of them are good, but some of them are not. But you can't necessarily go to that for the answers. You have to rely upon God. Amen. And one of the things that I want to finish off by telling us is that you actually have the greatest teacher living in you. Because we may have some good teachers in the church, but the greatest teacher, the greatest teacher, the greatest teacher is Jesus. And his spirit dwells within us. And he teaches us, the Bible says, and guides us. Yes, he does. Into all truth. So much, everything that we need really is within us. There's some times when we're looking outside of us when we need to look within us. Because what we need is within us. Because the Spirit of God dwells within. Now, the most important thing in life's challenges as a believer is to know who you are. And let me just read this. Romans. So turn your Bibles while I get top of this water to Romans chapter 8. And I could actually read all of this chapter up to verse 17, but I won't for time. I'll just read. Well, let me read from 1 to 70. I know it's a long passage, but let me do that. We're not trying to deal with all of it, but let me just try and do that for context. So Romans 8, and I'll just read whilst you're finding it. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, on account of sin. He condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God. For it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can be. So then, those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But verses 9 says, but you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his. And if Christ is not in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the Spirit of adoption, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. The meaning of God's word, let's say, praise the Lord. This is a long scripture, and there's so much in what we have just read. So I want to just focus a little bit on the fact that we have in Christ the Spirit of the Lord. So if you're saved today, then verses 9, you can say, or I can say to you, but you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. Because if you are saved, the Spirit of God is in your life. If he's not in your life, you're none of his. That's what it's saying to us. And And I'm not really going to get into definitions of flesh and all this, but let's just look at that in terms of our natural person, our natural body, with all of its passions. You know, and if you, I was reading, and you know, if you're filled with jealousy, with envy, with, I don't know, sexual desires, with anger, if you have these passions in you of the nature, you know, of your natural nature, if you have them in you and you don't allow the Lord to help you, they will come out in the way you live. People don't just do things wrong to somebody simply for that. There's always some passion behind it. There's always some reason behind it. Something that you have not dealt with in your heart. But the Bible is telling us that there is this tension between the spirit and the flesh. Now, today, if your identity today is in your family name, or your status in society, or your job, or your children, your siblings, your ethnicity, your culture, whatever, if your identity is in that today, you have a problem. Amen. Children will fail you. Yeah. Yes? Jobs come and go. All right. I like football, I still play at 54. That's not bad, is it? I played on Friday and we won. Oh no, it was a draw. I'd hope we'd won, but it was a draw. Anyway, but I still love my football. But I was reading this. Account of a footballer, and he was basically saying, you know, how after he finished playing football and he was no longer with the lads, could no longer go to the training ground and no longer do anything like that. You know, now the club don't write to him. Nobody wants to know him now. He's passed. He's done it. You know, it's now the younger people they're focusing on. And he was saying how one day he came so bad that he decided to kill himself. And the only reason he says that he didn't kill himself was because of his son. And I'm just using that as an example. Everything in our lives will change. Everything. You know, one of the things that I always say to myself, and when I preach, I do use myself a lot, so don't worry about that. But one of the things, okay, Jackie, if you behave, I won't mention your name. But if you don't behave... but one of the things I always say to myself is that when I finish, in terms of when God finishes with my ministry, I want to be able to just get down, sit down, and still be strong in my faith, happy in God, loving Jesus, not feeling like I have to fight for anything, hold on to anything, but can just be what God wants me to be at that time. I remember when I was younger, I always used to pray to God that, Father, the faith that I have now, let that faith be stronger when I finish. Amen. Hallelujah. And what I'm saying today is everything around you will change. Your status will go. Your job will go. Your very children whom you will sacrifice everything for now, they will go. And if you're lucky, they may call you. You better hope you have some girls. Janet and I was coming along in the car and we were talking about that when you've got the girls, they tend to look after you and want to be there. The boys just fly the nest. They just come back now and then for mummy's cooking, but you know, and they live with us. But the point I'm making is that, you know, sometimes people give everything to their children, and then the same children just leaves them. What I'm saying is everything around you will change. And the thing that is the strongest thing in your life that you should be holding on to is your identity in Christ. Because the commitment that Jesus makes to us, makes with us, is an eternal one. It never changes. In fact, it goes from glory to glory to glory to glory. It never ceases. And one day we shall behold him face to face. We shall see him as he is, and we shall be like him. Oh, hallelujah. I mean, that's glorious. That is not no we don't have to depend on fairy tale endings. We can just depend on the truth. Oh, praise the Lord. And all of this has relevance in terms of how we see ourselves. I mean, the world is always going to see you in a certain way. That's never going to change. But that must never worry you. You just need to know your identity is in Christ. Now, tensions between the flesh and the spirit are real for every one of us who has accepted Jesus and now seek to live for him. You have been raised to a new life in the spirit. Your spirit that was dead is now alive to God, and you are now living this new life. And part of this tension is that you are now living this new life in the spirit, but the body, the natural person, keeps trying to tell you that what you're doing is not right. It keeps trying to tell you, don't go that way, come back this way. Yeah. Now, when I was first in ministry, we used to preach that the Adamic nature was eradicated. Now, I believe in sanctification of the spirit. I believe positionally in sanctification, and I believe in progressive sanctification. But I believe that we have to struggle through day by day yielding, and that's the word I'm going to come to. We have to yield ourselves to the Spirit. Everybody wants to see the results that the apostles saw, but nobody wants to yield themselves to the Spirit. Sometimes we look at people's lives and we say, I want to be like that person. But if you want to be like that person, many times that person has learned to yield themselves to the Spirit of God. And when they yield themselves to the Spirit, sometimes it is hard. Oh, hallelujah. Help us, Lord. Help us, Lord. You see, Let me just go on to something else. But listen, even the wonderful thing like prayer. How wonderful is prayer? You find prayer wonderful?
Yes.
But it's hard. It's wonderful, but it's hard. You see, there's nothing greater when you're in the presence of God, communing with him as friend with friend, but it's hard. It takes a pushing. It takes sacrifices. It takes that you give up something that you can reach out to God. And sometimes I've learned in my life that I remember Bishop Barlack preaching that the devil sometimes give you good things to keep you away from the best. And there are many times, sometimes in my life, when you are doing all the good things, you're visiting everybody, you're doing all the things that you meant to do, but you realize that the communion, that fellowship with God that you need, is not there. I say sometimes to brethren in Croydon, you know, it's no point me visiting you if I'm not relating to God in the way that I should be. Because all I'm doing is just saying, I visited. That's just the flesh. Tick box, yes. Just the flesh. That doesn't really help. People want somebody to visit, not just ministers, but somebody to visit them that can come and say they have been spending time with God, Pastor Harold, that they can bring something from God into their situation. But in order to do that, you've got to spend time with God. Oh, hallelujah. So that when you're in that situation, you don't have to think, what am I going to say? You don't have to think, what scripture am I going to read? You don't have to think, what song you're going to speak. Because the Spirit of the Lord is speaking through you. Because you know him. And he knows you. You know his voice. You know what he's saying at that time. Oh, hallelujah. And so you can release what is in you to bless somebody else. But this tension between the Spirit of God and the flesh is a constant struggle. Yes. And I wrote here, we must therefore intentionally. And there's a lot of people using that word now, intentionally. Because when you intentionally do something, it's not just something that it just happens. You've got to really make up in your mind that you are going to do something. You have an intent, and through that intent, you do something. And we have to intentionally make up in our minds that we are going to believe what the Spirit of the Lord is saying, and that we're going to yield to what the Spirit of the Lord is saying, and we're going to do what the Spirit of the Lord tells us to do. It has to be intentional. Romans 6:4 says, therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so, we also should walk in newness of life. Jesus died in history once for all. And because he died in history once for all, and he was crucified, and he's killed, and he's delivered us from the bondage of sin. And now we can, through our faith in him, also now live this new life. Now, I was looking into this and just thinking about some of this. Jesus was raised physically, but we are raised spiritually. We were dead spiritually. He quickened who were dead in your trespasses and sins. Hallelujah. We have been raised spiritually. Jesus was raised physically. Hallelujah. Jesus ascends back to the Father, and he goes back bodily with his new body. Hallelujah. But we ascend. We are in heavenly places today, but we're not in heavenly places in our bodies. We're in heavenly places in our spirit. And I was thinking to myself, let's be very frank about it. We're sitting in a church in Alberton. So when Ephesians says that, you know, that you're now raised with Christ in heavenly places, where are you? You're in Alberton. But spiritually, you are raised with Christ in the heavenly places. Can we praise God for that? You see, what I'm trying to say to you, this is not just a person sitting on a chair in Alberton who is just a normal person. You are a person, Audrey, with the Spirit of the Lord in your life. Amen. Your spirit is now raised with Christ. Amen. And it's in the heavenlies. Amen. Your citizenship is in heaven. Amen. There's something about you that always wants to connect with heaven. Amen. Oh, hallelujah. And you desire heaven in your heart. Amen. You long to see your Savior. You know that you are not meant just to be here. You know there's something spiritual, something supernatural that has happened to you. Yes. And you can't talk about that with people that don't know God. Because if you tell them that your spirit has been made alive in God and you're now seated in the heavenly, they're going to think you're mad. Yes. Oh, hallelujah. But what I'm trying to say today, we're not just. And that is part of the problem, is that we allow our minds to just drag us down. And it's like we're trundling along and struggling in life. Oh, I just got to make it through today. Listen, we've got to make it through today, but we're making it through today as blood-washed saints of the Most High God, of children of the living God. We're making it through today with the power of the Holy Ghost in our lives. We're making it through today with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost who made their abode within us. So yes, sometimes you've got to struggle through, but you're struggling with divine help. Oh, hallelujah. And you believe and you know that God is going to take you through. Listen to me, there's a difference when you know in a situation that you're coming out and when you don't know. Oh, hallelujah. I remember when Janet was ill, and when she was, when effectively, that they, most of the doctors didn't really think she'd live. But I remember that I went home that night, and I cried to God like I had never cried to God before, by the side of my bed. And by the time I got up in the morning, I knew everything was well. And if you met me, you might think to myself, does this guy really love his wife? Because life was going on. And I wasn't in pity, pity land. I was actually, I had a faith in God. Janet and I are going through a situation right now, and we have a faith in God. And when you have a faith in God that God is going to bring you through, you're different. You are different. You see, we talk about being witnesses for God, but what the world wants to see is somebody that is filled with the Holy Ghost that can be, that can show them how to deal with the challenges of life. Somebody that they can say, how are they making it? How are they getting through that situation? Why are they laughing? What is happening in that person's life? And when they come to you, you say, it is Jesus. Jesus is the one that is sustaining me through this situation. Oh, hallelujah. Glory to God. Praise the name of Jesus. Listen to me. There is nothing. Let me tell you. There is nothing that the child of God cannot go through if your faith is in God. And that don't mean it's going to look good. Sometimes it looks really bad. I was watching a dramatization of Abraham. And when sometimes we read about Abraham, the man of faith, and we talk about him in the scripture, but this dramatization showed some things, just made me think. First of all, he's just living in tents and whatever. He's just wandering around. His wife thinks he's mad. He's left his family. He's left all that good, all that glory, and all that things that he had with his father. He's wandering around in the desert. He's talking about God. Nobody sees God. Nobody knows what's happening to him. He's actually in a very difficult situation. But Abraham had faith in God. And every time Abraham needed something, God came to him and spoke to him to say that I am your God. When was the last time that God spoke to you and said, I am your God? We need God to speak to us. It's nice to hear from the pastor. It's nice to hear from the worship leader. But there are times when you need God through the Spirit to speak in your innermost being. Oh, hallelujah. Glory to God. When nothing else will suffice. But you need something from God. Something that makes you know that indeed you have been raised with Christ in the heavenlies. Something that makes you know that your citizenship is in heaven. Something that makes you know that you are not of this world. But you're a child of God. You see, if we can believe this, there's nothing we can't do. I guarantee you that most of the times, if not all the times, that we have our pity parties, that we talk ourselves down, it is because we have forgotten who we are. Because as long as you remember who you are, you know there's a way out. You know there's a way. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I just praise the Lord. Sometimes in my life, I've just seen God open doors. And I'm thinking to myself, you know, sometimes you have to pinch yourself. And we sing songs like, count your blessings, name them one by one, and it'll surprise you. Lord, you have to do it. You have to do it because you do not actually sometimes really appreciate what God has done for you. Hallelujah. And so you have to constantly be reminding yourself of who you are. So when Ephesians 2 and 6 tells us that we have been raised in these heavenly places in Christ, It's in your spirit.
Amen.
You are now connected with God through your spirit. Yeah. And you're lifted to this heavenly realm in God. Yeah. You're actually hearing from heaven. Yeah. Yeah. Hallelujah. And one writer says that we have to like practice like we're really dead. We have to really, we've got to walk around as though we're really dead to this world. This body is dead, and that we're now alive in the, you see, this thing is real. This thing is not a joke. This thing is not something that you can just read over and pass over as though it doesn't really have resonance and really have importance for your life. It has importance for your life.
Amen.
You have to understand that. And you are indeed raised with God. And that's one of the things that he's trying to tell us. Now, if you go back to, if we talk about empowerment, and there's many definitions for empowerment. And usually when you're talking about empowerment, somebody is empowered to do something. They're released, they're given resources, or they're given knowledge, they're given understanding, they're given authority. Could be legal, could be moral, whatever. And they're given that authority, that power to begin to do something that they would not ordinarily do.
Yes.
If it's at work and they empower you, they may give you a new position. They make you a manager. They give you the resources. They begin to let you do something that you had not done before. They empower you to make decisions. All of a sudden, you are walking in the office as just an office staff. Now you're walking as a manager. You can say to somebody, I want you to move from here and go over to there and do that piece of work, because you now have authority. Somebody has given you authority. And now when we are empowered by God and we're his children, we are given authority. That's why the Bible says that when we believe in him, he has given us the power to become the sons of God. We now have authority to operate in the world as the children of God. Not just as children of God, but as the scripture says, as heirs of the Father. You talk about what you may have in the bank. You talk about what inheritance you're going to get from your mother or your father. But you should talk about the inheritance that you are going to inherit from the Father who is in heaven. Because you are now an heir of the Father and a joint heir with Jesus Christ. Now if that is not empowerment, what is? And you see, if you begin to really believe that, you can't just sit down here like you're just some poor thing. You can't do it. You see, people who are making great strides in the kingdom of God, it is because they believe that they are children of God. And they know that they have resources. They know that they have power. I have one, thank you very much. They know that they have those things in God. They know that. And so therefore, when they know that and they see a building down the road for £2 million, they don't say, oh, I can't afford that.
That's right. Come on,
if God tells them,
yes,
that it's for them,
right,
and God is their Father,
yes,
and they are an heir of this Father,
yes,
and a joint heir with Jesus Christ. And if God owns everything that you can see with your eyes, if he created it all and it all belongs to him, then surely if he wants to give you that building down the road, then there's nothing that can stop you from getting that building. But all you've got to do is believe in who you are in God and know that if you are a child of God, you have resources unlimited. Your Father is able to do all things. Oh, hallelujah. We've got to believe that. Praise the Lord. You see, when you believe that, you begin to do things. When you don't believe that, all you do is have committees. After committees. Let's have another committee meeting. And another committee meeting. And before you know it, 3-4 years have gone by, and you're still planning another committee meeting. Listen to me, committee meetings have their place. But if you talk about an issue over and over again and never do anything, it probably means you don't want to do anything. Oh, glory to God, hallelujah. praise the name of Jesus. You know, I remember when we were refurbishing our building in Croydon, and some of the people never thought we could do it. And we probably spent nearly £250,000, and we never borrowed a penny from the bank. I remember that Bishop McCullough stood up in the ministers' convention, and he basically said that all the churches he has pastored, Abney Street, Gloucester Street, every single one of them, he has never gone to the bank for a penny. Do you know what? Some of our problem is everybody wants to be loved. Please love me. Yes, please. Everybody wants to be loved. And you know, when you want to be loved, you can be so infatuated with your own self and want to be loved that you never do anything to hurt anybody. Some people have the most friends in the world, but they can never tell any one of them you're wrong. It's very easy to have loads of friends if you never tell them that anything they do is wrong. I bet you'd love me if I never told you did anything wrong. It's easy peasy, isn't it? But you know, a true friend, you can tell them you were wrong. And if they don't love you for that, then the friendship probably wasn't all that anyway. And what I'm saying is that, let me get back to the message. What I'm saying is that if you know who you are in God, you don't have to play those games. You don't have to play. There's some times you've got to stand and everybody around you will be saying, what on earth is that person doing? But you know. And you see, part of the challenge is, and this is not easy, but part of the challenge is knowing the voice of God. Everybody knows the voice of God. You know, it's a wonderful thing when people are going to say something, they start off by saying, I'm the Spirit or the Lord told me. And then when they do that, it means that you must now listen because I've heard from God. But listen to me, sometimes when people say, I'm the Lord, I've said, that's when you must test it. And I'm saying that for myself. I think that one of the hardest things in your Christian journey is to actually know what God is saying in a given situation. It is not so easy. And that's why we need one another. Because there's safety in a multitude of counselors. And that's why sometimes we've got to get together and we've got to talk about things. And we've got to, if you feel that God is saying something to you, sometimes you need elders, you need people to sit with you and listen to you and evaluate what you're saying.
Amen.
Hallelujah. But one of the last points on empowerment, just before I move on to something else. One of the things about empowerment is self-actualization. Because we have potential. And you want to fulfill your potential, don't you? What do you find frustrating in life? It's when you have potential, and you know that you have that potential, but you just can't get to do what you want to do. Hallelujah. But the thing is that God, who created us, who called us, he knows. In fact, I got something that was written there that was saying that, you know, one of the things is that we think that we need to know the voice of, or we need to know what so-and-so says about us, and we want to know what the pastor says about us, and even what we think about ourselves. Well, none of that matters. It's what God says. What does God say about you? What is God's plan for you? Hallelujah. And if we can learn to trust God, God will bring everything in place for what you need to fulfill what he has called you to fulfill. Part of our problem is that we go off. God is saying wait. But we say no. So-and-so is saying they can help me. And you go off in this direction. And then they take you in this direction. and this direction. And they take you all around. And eventually, you have to come back. To where God wanted you to be. It's a bit like, was it Elijah? Who was it was running away from Jezebel? God had to bring him right back to where he needed to be. To do what he wanted him to do. And let me tell you, and so that is part of our struggle. Now, I hope that you're getting something. But listen, I was saying to Brethren Croydon, and I'm learning this in my life, is that you never, God helps you through the consequences of your sins. But you have to go through them. And some of the consequences for our sins are very hard. And God will walk with us through that. And he will help you through, Pastor Harold. But he doesn't just eradicate it. Sometimes it's hard. Isn't it? And you're praying and you're asking God if you could just take away these consequences. But sometimes it's just that you've got to go through it. And you know what I learned from that? I learned from that it is always better to do what God wants you to do than to go off on your tangents. Because your tangents have consequences. And your tangents will always bring you back to God. And God is like that like the prodigal son. The father is on the way. And he's saying, come. Hallelujah. And he will receive us. But sometimes the consequences are hard. Now, I just want to take you through a couple of these verses before I look at one more thing. Now, if we turn to the scripture in 8. So, what I'm saying is that God wants you to know who you are. Okay? And you are dead, or you should be dead, to your sins. And you should now be living for God. Romans 6 and 10, before I go back to 8, it says, for the death that he died to sin once for all. But the life that he lives to God. And now, verse 11 of Romans 6 says, likewise, also, reckon yourselves to be dead, indeed to sin, but to alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And what Paul is saying there is that that word reckon could also be account. And what he's saying to us is that we've got to behave, we've got to account ourselves, we've got to reckon ourselves as though we were dead. If you tell a dead man to walk, will he walk?
No.
No. You tell a dead man to speak, will he speak?
No.
No. And that is what we have to be. We have to be like we are dead. Reckon ourselves, in fact, to be dead to the flesh. So when the flesh speaks to us, we're dead. So the flesh speaks to you and it tries to bring up the passion of envy in your life over somebody, but you're dead. I can't envy, I'm dead. And so you turn yourself to the things of God. You recognize that you are indeed dead to sin. And you are alive to God. And then it says in verses 12 and 8, it says, therefore, brethren, we are debtors. So our debt is not to the flesh to live according to the flesh, but our debt is to the Spirit. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. Hallelujah. And so we always talk about a debt. We owe a debt. But the debt that we owe is to God, to the Spirit, to listen to the Spirit of God and not to listen to the flesh. And just to break this down even a little bit more, if I was to just kind of, you know, and it can be very simple. It can be very, very simple in your life. And every single one of us, we know what it's like. You know, somebody hurts you and the flesh says, oh, right, I'm going to get this person, right? And what I'm going to do is I'm going to phone up so-and-so. And then you phone up so-and-so. And you tell so-and-so the story. But you tell so-and-so the story so that they begin to hate the person as well. And then you tell so-and-so the story as well. And so-and-so and whoever so-and-so is. And by the time you finish, you've got a little clique. And the people of that clique, they're foolish. Because Solomon says, how can you judge a matter unless you have heard the whole matter? But all they've done is heard your side of the story, but already now you're a clique. Now that person is not getting in this group. You see, when I say that to you right now, that sounds mad, doesn't it? But that happens in churches. It happens. It happens in churches. And it happens because that wrestling with the flesh is there. And sometimes it's the Spirit of the Lord is saying, don't do that. Don't do that. Get on your knees and pray to me. I'm going to give you the strength. I'm going to show you how to deal with this situation. But while the Spirit of the Lord is saying that, the flesh is saying, how can you let that person walk all over you and do that? And you see, you're in the right. You might be in the right. And a lot of times we're in the right. But our good is evil spoken of because we take matters into our own hands. But what this scripture is telling us is you are dead. So when that flesh rises up to you and says, go and get on the phone, you say to the flesh, I'm dead. I'm dead to sin. I have a debtor now to the Spirit of God. I don't owe you a debt. Oh, hallelujah. It's a blessing when we don't owe the devil a debt. We don't have to follow him. You know, one of the things I praise God for is that no sin has dominion over us. He doesn't have dominion over us. If we allow a sin to have dominion over us, it is because we have chosen to believe it. A lie. But no sin. Can we praise the Lord for that? You don't need to do it. You are not a debtor to that. You are now, hallelujah, a debtor to the Spirit. Oh, praise the name of Jesus. Then he says, for as many as are led by the Spirit of the Lord, they're the sons of God. Hallelujah. They're the sons of God. Hallelujah. You see, right now, this is a wonderful service. Are you blessed? I'm blessed. I'm so blessed. And I'm not talking about me. I'm blessed in this service. Everything that God has done, his intervention, everything. I'm blessed. Praise God. It's easy to preach when God is working like this. Sometimes a worship leader gives you the service, you think, oh no. But today you feel yes. Lord, I'm ready to speak for you. Yes. It's a wonderful service. But listen, God wants to lead us. Yes. He wants to lead you through his Spirit. Yes. And you see, we've got to make up our minds when we leave this convention that whatever the Spirit of the Lord tells me to do, I'm going to do. Yes. Hallelujah. I am going to do it because I want to follow the leading of the Spirit. One thing is for sure is that the Spirit is speaking. And all we've got to do is listen and apply what he says to our hearts. Oh, hallelujah. And he will lead us. And he will direct us. Praise the name of the Lord. You see, a key part of empowerment is to give knowledge of something. And to teach and to equip people. And that's one of the problems sometimes when people empower you. They give you something to do. They don't give you any resources. They don't give you any training. And they just give it to you. And then you've got to try and find a way of doing something. But when God empowers us, he teaches us. Hallelujah. And he wants us to know. And Paul here, to empower someone, therefore, has to involve communication. It has to involve sharing of knowledge and information to influence how the individual sees themselves and for them to understand that they can begin now to operate in that thing that you have asked them to do. And Paul, he sees this constant struggle and he's trying to get the believers to listen to the Spirit of God who communicates to us. And that's why St. John 16:13 says, you know, that when the Spirit of truth is come, he will guide us into all truth. And it says he will not speak of himself, but he will speak the things that he hears of the Father and he will tell us things to come. Yeah. Hallelujah. Spirit of the Lord is speaking. Yeah. He's speaking right now in our hearts. He's speaking in our life. And he is the greatest teacher. Amen. And you know, in the world today now, we talk about lifelong learning, don't we? Is there ever any time when you stop learning? No, we're always learning. But I'm telling you that in the kingdom of God, it's definitely lifetime learning. Because you are constantly having to learn more and more about God. You're trying to understand the unsearchable God. I always say the finite is trying to understand the infinite. If you think about the conundrum of the finite trying to understand the infinite, you would realize that it's not possible that we can fully understand someone who is infinite if we're finite. And so the learning never stops. Praise the name of Jesus. It never stops. And so he's constantly teaching us and guiding us and leading us. And we need that leading of the Spirit. And when John speaks of it in 1 John 2, you can turn there. He talks about that unction that is within us. That unction from the Holy Ghost. He talks to us. He teaches us. He guides us. He helps us. And let me tell you, I was thinking about this, how privileged we are. And, you know, one of the things that when we have our communion services, and I know that I'm not the only one that finds this hard, but when we have our communion services, sometimes it is very hard to really begin to discern what Jesus has done for you. Amen. And if you say to me that's not true, I'd like to talk to you afterwards because I want to know how you have no problem with that. But in our communion service, sometimes I have to really, you know, intentionally begin to think about what Jesus has done for me. And in my spirit, I'm trying to really commune with the Spirit of God to understand that awe, that wonder, that thankfulness, that gratitude for what he has done flows from within because I'm communing with him and understanding what he has done and not just because somebody tells me to do it. Amen. And that is a struggle that we have. So we've got to constantly be asking the Spirit of the Lord to help us, to guide us, to teach us, to show us what Jesus has done for us. And you see, the more that the Spirit begins to tell you these things, it's the more privileged you are. You realize you are. The Bible says, what is man that you are mindful of him? Why should God choose to come into our lives to tell us about who he is? Why does God love us so? We're not even lovable, are we? And we do so much to hurt him. We grieve the Spirit so often. And yet God continues to love us. Hallelujah. What a privilege. What a privilege it is to be children of the Most High God. I'm going to finish with this and we're going to pray. And in Hebrews 2:1 it says, we ought to give the most earnest heed to the things we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. And this morning when I was praying, God was showing to me and he was saying to me, Tell somebody today who is maybe just clinging to me to keep clinging, to keep holding on. And he showed me like a cliff. And you know when you've got these films on the television when you see someone hanging over the cliff and somebody is holding them, trying to hold them, and they're trying to hold on to that person. That person is holding them. And I know that God is holding us. I know that makes a big difference. But we must also just try to cling, just to hold on to him. And I want to encourage us today to hold on. If you've got him firm, hold on. If you're just about clinging with your fingertips, hold on. Hallelujah. But hold on to Jesus. Thank God today that you are a child of God. Say, thank God I'm a child of God. Hallelujah. Stand with me at this time. Oh, hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise God. I'd love us just to have an appropriate song. I can't think of one in my heart. Who was following me and has something in their heart? Let's just sing something very prayerful. We're going to just have, is that all right, just to have a time of prayer? Yeah? And then we will close. We need to close for 1:30. We're going to have a time of prayer. Let's lift our hearts to the Lord. And I know that I've said a lot. I tried not to say too much, but sometimes that's just the way it is. But just try to hold on to one or two things today. And those one or two things are that you are a child of God. Yeah. And that there is a tension between the spirit and the flesh. But you're not a debtor to the flesh. You are, hallelujah, supposed to follow the leading of the spirit. Then you can truly say, I am a child.